Well, the Reserve Bank is expected to hike the official cash rate to 4% in the next year as global policymakers try to curb the effects of inflation.
Now, if that forecast rings true, it'll have a huge impact on homeowners and the property market. Here to tell us more, we're joined by Alice Stoltz from Domain. Nice to see you. What are your thoughts on this? Do you think we'll see 4% next year?
Good morning, guys. Well, look, we know that the RBA is going to continue to hike up in interest rates, and it could be a bit like getting a lump of coal for Christmas for many homeowners, it's looking like. The only solace, of course, is that for first-time buyers, it is going to help soften prices further.
OK. In some good news for those looking to buy, it does seem like the era of underquoting is finally coming to an end. What more can you tell us?
Yeah, look, we think it could be RIP underquoting at the moment. This is a hot button topic in property, and everybody's experienced or knows someone who's experienced that thing of having to add 20% on to a price guide often, and then that soul destroying, you know, impact afterwards of missing out at auction because the quote was way off. But you can see on the screen here, basically, we're seeing a lower level of complaints to fair trading, particularly in New South Wales. What happens is during a hot market, the rise of underquoting is more prevalent because the market is changing so quickly and agents sometimes are a bit loose in what they're quoting. In a cooler market, though, there's less risk of that happening, and many buyers are experiencing that now and finally getting more accurate price quotes.
So, Alice, what advice would you give to, say, future buyers?
Look, I think future buyers need to remember that they are in the hot seat, or the driving seat at the moment, which is fantastic news for them, but insist on a price guide. Go to auctions, look at what's passing in, look at what happens after an auction, because sometimes agents aren't reporting results, so you need to do the sort of hard work yourself, I suppose. Get your intel, put in your best offer, and remember, you are in the driver's seat, so enjoy that moment while we've got it.
Good on you, Alice. Thank you so
Thanks,
much.
Alice.
Appreciate it. Welcome back to the show. As wages continue to slowly rise, new data has revealed Aussie salary increases could be even better than first thought.
But many Aussies still aren't earning the market value for their skills and experience. So could you be eligible for a pay rise? FER Zahos knows the answer to that, don't you?
Well, I hope so.
Tell us about this new data.
Yeah, so this has come out by job-seeking platform Seek. It's the first one. And actually what it shows is that advertised salaries have gone up for the past 12 months up until July by 4.1%. Now, that's quite different from what the ABS data recently came out. Remember, the wage price index was only 2.6. So you're probably saying, well, what's the difference? Why is this person saying that it's gone up more when the government stat says not as much? The difference is this is advertised jobs, so new jobs. The ABS is existing jobs. So when you think about that, you realise if you've been in the same job for a while, chances are if you move or you negotiate, you'll get a better wage because the going rates have gone up. Northern Territory highest does not necessarily mean you paid the highest. In fact, if you want the highest paying jobs, they're in the ACT. Unfortunately, beautiful Tassie has the lowest paying jobs at around about $80,000.
Okay, let's start with office jobs. So what's changed?
Okay, so with office jobs, if you are in IT, you can basically call it. Really, I mean, I'm seeing that in the jobs that I'm involved with, and I'm seeing that on this platform. So they've actually got the highest paying job. That is the average full-time salary. Even though it hasn't gone up the highest is design and architecture there at 7.3%.
What about outdoor jobs?
OK, so if you like the sun, then you'll like these pay packets. they're not as high, some of those, as the other ones. The indoor jobs, probably one of the perks of being outdoors, is you have to take less pay. But on average, they've all gone over that 3% mark, which is good, and it's broad-based, which I like even better. But still, when you think inflation, that 6.1%, they're still not as high.
OK, if you think, you know, you can get out there and see what else is around, competition is fierce at the moment. You think you're being underpaid, what can you do?
Yeah, well, you've got to understand the reality here too. So when you look at who has seen big increases, so when you see that first one, the lowest paid, over the past 12 months, that's gone up 7.1%. The lowest paid, that falls in retail, hospitality, margins are tight there. So I've got to be honest, you can't basically go out after seeing this segment and go, you know, if you're in, you know, a bartender and say, I need a pay increase, margins are tight there. What you're going to have to find is that maybe other ways of doing or move jobs. because of shortages as well. Highest paid, even though that hasn't caught up to the lowest paid, they're seeing the biggest rate hikes that you can actually get on your pay. So basically, know your worth. Get online, type in. They've all got these calculators. Type in your occupation. It'll tell you what your job is. Your soft skills. If you've got communication, analytical skills, sell that to move into another position. But basically, like the data shows, if you've been in your same job for, you know, 12 months, you may be better move or first ask, Ali, which is something that we might all do today.
Soft skills, eh? Why are they called soft skills?
Soft skills, anyway, transferable skills.
It's a brand new hour right here on Today. Businesses in New South Wales could soon be fined $55,000 if they're caught handing out plastic cutlery, straws and other items.
For more, we're joined by Council of Small Business CEO Alexi Boyd in Canberra. Nice to see you this morning, Alexi. What do you make of this one?
Well, look, it is certainly one of those tricky situations that small businesses find themselves in. And when it comes to these sort of things, it's about education first and enforcement second. And we would encourage the New South Wales government to do its best to educate small businesses, particularly through their industry associations, about what they are expected to do and the deadline by which they need to meet this. It's quite a large fine for small businesses. If you are a small business and you're not aware that you're doing the wrong thing, a $55,000 fine is a pretty big slap. So what we'd like to see the government do is redouble its efforts to make sure that small businesses are aware, talk to industry associations who are on board with this in terms of what is required of retailers and of the hospitality industry, and let's get this moving into a positive direction.
It is a hell of a fine though, isn't it, for a small business?
It certainly is. I mean, it's a big difference, especially at the moment with all the other costs that are going up for small businesses. Many of them would see this fine as something that could possibly, you know, see them have to walk out the door. But before that, it's really important that we encourage the state government to do its best. There's already some good campaigning going on, some good education, but those efforts need to be redoubled, particularly since the fines are so high.
Yeah, well, those laws will come into effect in November, so hopefully that's enough time for small business. Lexi, on another note, I did notice the other day that you've been criticised by the Chamber of Commerce for striking this deal with the unions ahead of the job summit, saying it's not a good deal for your members.
Well, look, we will work with anybody who tries to make things better for small business. And right now, the difficulty for small businesses when they are employing people is around the complexity of the IR system. And we need to speak to key stakeholders in that system, and the ACTU is one of those people. We would welcome the opportunity to speak to anyone to make it simpler. But now we need to talk about making it simpler with small businesses at the forefront of those discussions. And that's what's been missing up until now.
How are small businesses receiving the notion of you doing a deal with the unions?
Well, we've had some really good feedback from our members. They're fully supportive of this idea of actually making sure that it's about compliance, it's about getting things right, and it's about education to help small businesses do the right thing. It's a tricky situation, obviously, but we're here to talk to all stakeholders, and this is just the beginning of a conversation. It's going to take a long time to find consensus, but that's what we're trying to do.
How do you feel that the summit's going to go? It is only 2 days, but obviously there are a whole lot of conversations taking place behind the scenes. And I guess, what are you pushing for, what you see is the biggest challenge for small business right now?
Well, we're really proud to be representing small businesses alongside the Australian Retailers Association and other members that are attending as well. And what's really important to us is that we examine the problem of worker shortages first and foremost. You ask any small business owner, and that is their number one issue right now. So what can we do in these 2 days and in the few days afterwards to see some announcements that actually relieve the pressure on small businesses to get those workers maximising their engagement? And then we can look at important issues such as migration to assist with those worker shortages, and obviously the vet and skills sector is very important as well for the long term.
Yeah, I think staff shortages would be a big one for small business. Alexi, thank you so much. Carl. Well, despite the tough times, retail sales are the highest in 4 months. Here to explain is President of the National Retail Association, Dominic Lamb, in Brisbane. Dom, nice to see you this morning. Are we buying more, or is it just that everything's more expensive?
Look, I think when we look at these ABS stats, of course, it's a great news that we've seen an increase, but they are still quite flat with a 0.9% increase for the April quarter. And we know that our consumers are certainly spending more when it comes to things like fuel, certainly any of those fresh produce items, because we know that, of course, we've seen those, you know, increases in prices. And our discretionary spend is certainly still down.
So how are people tightening their belts?
Look, we know that they're making different choices. If they don't need something, then perhaps they're waiting or holding off from buying it. Of course, you know, we are around the end of financial year period, so we are seeing tax returns start to come in. So there's often a little bit of a spike at this time around spending. But people are really starting to kind of watch those pennies and make sure that, you know, where they are making purchases, it's for things that they need.
Well, we know that wages aren't keeping up with inflation. What are you expecting the retail numbers to do over the next few months?
Look, there's no doubt that from our anecdotal evidence, from our membership, that they're telling us that things are getting harder, that people are starting to tighten their belts. So we expect that these figures are going to continue to flatten out. And then, of course, once we hit that November period and we start to see all of those, you know, incredible sales start to come up, that's when we'll see a spike again in time for Christmas.
All right. Good to talk to you, Dom. Thank you.